By the Golden Gate Bridge and under the CN Tower, you'll find ultimate play at another level. You'll see desire. You'll view explosiveness. You will enjoy athletic precision. The last two AUDL champions meet in tonight's second semifinal, San Jose and Toronto right now. Welcome again to Avaya Stadium in San Jose, California. The Madison Radicals await the winner of tonight's second semifinal. The last two AUDL champions going head-to-head. It was the Rush in 2013. The San Jose Spiders in their first season won it all in 2014. And tonight, one of these teams will advance to the 2015 championship game scheduled for tomorrow afternoon here at Avaya Stadium. Hi again, everybody. Evan Leppler alongside Chuck Kindred and Megan Tormey. There's been great anticipation for this game all week as well. I think a lot of people consider the Spiders the favorites, but the Toronto Rush, Megan, told us earlier today that they believe they can win, and there was something in their voice that made me believe them.
Absolutely. They are walking in with the confidence of someone who has studied long and hard for a test. They reviewed the things that went poorly for them at the end of last season and have spent the entire season honing those things, and we will see them come out today.
And they've certainly peaked at the right time, an incredible winning streak heading into championship weekend. And then there's the San Jose team. They rely on their depth, but they're also banged up. We talked with Bo Kittredge earlier, the star for the Spiders, feeling better than he was a couple of weeks ago, but it doesn't look like he's 100%. He's going to play defense, not offense.
Yeah, it's an interesting change. I think he's a guy that seems to just show up when it counts. You know, sometimes he'll lollygag and he'll keep from doing a full warm-up or something like that. But, man, I would count on him showing up, especially if these guys are down late in the game. Expect the Bo factor to come into full effect as usual.
San Jose has a lot of guys on offense that they can count on, even if Bo's not out there. And you look at the Toronto Rush. A year ago at this time, we're talking about Mark Lloyd. He's a superstar. But this year, he only played 1 point all season long, out with a torn ACL. In his place, Isaiah Massacelli has gotten to a whole new level.
All you have to do is look at his stats and one highlight reel, and you realize here's a guy who does absolutely everything. But what I find more fascinating about him this season is he absolutely needed to step up, and he did. That speaks volumes about his ability to mentally hone in when it's necessary.
It's been fun to watch him grow more comfortable into being a team leader still in his early mid-20s. He's the star we're watching for Toronto. On the other side, now 33 years old, Bo Kittredge. Before the game, he was on the concourse chatting with the commissioner of the AUDL, Steve Gordon. Jimmy Mickle, Tyler DiGirolamo, a couple other of the stars wish they were playing in this game. Bo always warms up in pajama pants, and he sometimes starts the first quarter a little sleepy, Chuck, but as you said, by the fourth quarter, he usually rounds into form.
Yeah, the storm is brewing. Don't let it fool you. But you're right. You know, he's not the guy they need to show up to win. This is a deep team. They've got guys like Cassidy Rasmussen, Ashlyn Joy, Simon Higgins, and Greg Cohen, one of my favorites, who are out here and ready to bang.
He's going to be on defense. It'll be interesting to see if he matches up with Massacelli. Well, the Madison Radicals have moved on already. We're about to find out who will join the team from Wisconsin in the finals. Toronto and San Jose for the right to play tomorrow when we come back.
Strike up the band, Stevens Creek Toyota is ready for another all-star season. We're your home for everything Toyota in the South Bay. Experience Toyota Express service in our beautiful new facility, fast in, fast out service. We have deals to beat the band on Corolla, Sienna, and America's favorite hybrid, Prius. It's a performance you don't want to miss. Now it's Stevens Creek Toyota in San Jose. Visit us online at StevensCreekToyota.com.
What's all this?
My own line of products, Barkley 34.
Smells like a locker room.
Exactly. That's the round mound of pound cake.
Perfect. What's this?
The Rebounder. It's a dating app for the newly available.
Sounds promising. Can we build it?
Yes. CDW designed and installed our server infrastructure so we can respond quickly to any data demand.
Any?
Any. I like it.
Then you're gonna love Stir Charles.
picture perfect conditions for Ultimate. A little breezy, but that just makes things a little more interesting here at Avaya Stadium, home of the San Jose Earthquakes. The team from the Major League Soccer in the Bay Area lending us their stadium for championship weekend. You get a good look at what's going on at Spirit Challenge. Awesome suite level seating under the main bowl. There's a Raleigh Flyer trying to ease his pain by winning an accuracy competition. The Flyers fell short against the Madison Radicals. The second time in 3 years it's Madison in the title game. And there's Ashlyn Joy getting ready to take the field again. What does Ashlyn, does his role change offensively without Bo Kittredge out there? Is he pretty much just the same guy in all circumstances?
I think he's the same guy. Bo's one of the targets that he loves to throw to, but Ashlyn's, you know, he is an absolute Cadillac of a player. I mean, he's just going to make every offense work well. He's going to be getting the reset. He's got all the hucks, and he's got hucks to different angles than most guys have. He's able to hit IO lanes deep because of how wide and low he releases. So, I mean, he's just a ton of fun to play with, and he's got plenty of targets on the line right now. You see Marcelo Sanchez. You see guys like Cassidy Rasmus ready to work.
Andy's the type of thrower who will adjust to the receivers that he has before him. So, like you said, Chuck, loves throwing to Bo, but if Bo's out of the equation, he's going to find someone else he's equally as happy to throw to.
Toronto to begin this game on defense. Andrew Carroll, Remy Ojo, Jackie Howe, Phil Watanabe, Anatoly Vasiliev, Jeff Powell, and Gord Harrison set to pull. One guy whose role might change a little bit in the San Jose's offense without Bo Kittredge being out there is Simon Higgins. He's probably the closest player to Bo in terms of style that the Spiders have. Cassidy Rasmussen, the center handler on the first possession, and he hits Joy, who lined up in the stack. Winner of this game faces the Radicals tomorrow, and Remy Ojo got a piece of that throw. Simon Higgins hand blocked on his first flick of the game.
Remy Ojo, one of the defensive leaders of Toronto Rush, very early putting another stat in his favor.
Remember the first play in the championship game last year had a couple of awkward turnovers. The Spiders in the white, the Rush defensively in the red. San Jose does not have a full-time coach, Kevin Smith, a player, coach, captain, leader. He does it all from an organizational perspective, along with the owner, Andrew Zill. Toronto led by three-man coaching staff, Evan Phillips, Mark Lloyd, and Scott Shooter Hasty.
Rush putting on some relentless defense, pushing the Spiders back to their end zone.
Really making yards difficult to come by here. Joy was bumped by Harrison. And a contact call made. Officials here in game two tonight, Josh Cooper, Ali Reza, Mir Afzal, Kai Hudak, and John Thibodeau. Looking for Sanchez, what a grab. The Spiders on the board here at home.
You know, that very easily and should have gone the other way when the Rush got that turn early in the game. Tolley put up a beautiful break to Gord Harrison, who just misread it, didn't jump high enough to grab it. Those are the kind of mistakes that cost them this game last year.
Yeah, and Marcelo Sanchez, you know, goes up and makes a great catch. San Jose riding a lot of momentum. They're a very confident group. They're used to winning. They play together well, and you know, it doesn't hurt that they're at home right now. I mean, they're playing in San Jose, and they look very comfortable out there. Sanchez continues to improve. He led the Spiders 43 assists this year. And Marcelo is still just 23 years old. So the first offensive point, Kevin Cox will mark Thompson McKnight, Toronto's primary handler. Jeff Lindquist, guarded by Brett Peterson. Russell Wynn is chasing around Cameron Harris, who dumps it back, and a heck of a lefty grab by McKnight to keep possession alive. Matthew Natale's on Adrian Yearwood. Bo Kittredge is in fact on Massick Kelly, and Isaiah has not sniffed the disc yet. Greg Cohen out there chasing the Energizer Bunny, that is Steve Armitage. Here's Massick Kelly's first touch.
You know, we talked about it a couple weeks ago in the playoff game with Seattle, and for that matter, mainly with Seattle. You know, if Bo's not 100% and I'm Toronto, I would test him right now. I would send Massick Kelly deep. You know, even if it is a 50-50, I want to see that guy go up. I want to see what he's playing with, what he's capable of. Is this Bo or is this Bo light?
But the rest of the San Jose defenders are making it really difficult to get that kind of shot off. They are looking for these little plinko passes as they aim to get even just 5-10 yards out of a single pass.
Oh, Cohen went right into the side of Harris. A dangerous bid there, and the foul called. And Greg Cohen appearing apologetic in the immediate aftermath.
Yeah, but in that case, Greg is the one who can see everything in front of him, and it's his responsibility to protect the receiver there. You know, it's okay to say you're sorry after the fact, but you're the one who made the play.
They probably, you know, could have called an unsportsmanlike on that play without much argument. Toronto has slowly and methodically worked it down the field here, this point now 2 minutes old. And that may have been tipped by Peterson. He might have just nicked it on the bid. Sonny Zaccaro to pick up. He had been chasing Sashin Reyna around throughout the first point. And Kevin Cox takes a deep shot for Cohen. And Cohen rips it away over the shoulder of the Toronto Rush player. Zaccaro swings it. Spiders in the red zone with Wynn. And he sneaks it through to Cohen. A marathon point. 2.5 minutes, Toronto was so patient until one mistake, and as the Spiders so capably do, they pounced.
Yeah, and if I'm Kevin Smith, player coach of the San Jose Spiders here, I'm pretty happy with that point, because even though Toronto was resetting the dish, they were having to make a lot of throws, and in this win, which is picking up, by the way, I mean, it was already a little bit of an issue in our first game, I think it's gotten a little heavier. And it's not a straight win, as we discussed earlier. It swirls around. It makes catches like that turn into drops. I mean, that's not a hard catch.
How about this grab? The catch of the point.
Yeah, Armitage did a great job keeping up with Cohen. And, of course, there are a few people on the field who can keep up with anyone as well as Armitage can. But Greg Cohen went up early and perfectly to grab that disc, taking Armitage's chance completely out of the play.
Greg's teammates talk about what great timing he has, both offensively and defensively, on those jump balls. Massick Kelly takes a big shot into the hands of Andrew Carroll. He's had a really fine season for Toronto. Anatoly Vasiliev with a big swing from Massick Kelly. Scoober for Yearwood. He juggled it but held on. To Lindquist, and he's in.
Quite a jump from Lindquist to clear that end zone line. I have to say, that's some wherewithal to be able to grab that disc and know where the line is. Jump with both feet over it. That was amazing.
That was well done. This looks like a dance routine or something like this. A little high, little pirouetting scuba over the top to Yearwood, who turns and catches it, and then this move into the end zone. Yeah, it was impressive. I'm surprised he knew where he was well enough to make that happen.
Well, the assist goes to Yearwood, who is an actor, writer, and member of a theater company known as Echo Productions.
Yeah, you can see why. When he was in front of the camera earlier today on our pregame show, he looked very at ease and just very well-spoken and also very good-looking, actually. Very good-looking on camera.
Chuck, so are you.
Oh, you guys. I was fishing for that.
Rasmussen takes a shot. Right on the money for Sean Hamm. What a season Sean Hamm has had, and it's Higgins who picks up the goal. Hamm gets the helper. Great pressure again there from Remy Ojo. That, I'm starting to really like to watch that matchup. He can guard Higgins well, it seems like. Certainly will be a matchup to keep an eye on. But the thing about, you know, you shut down Higgins, then you got to deal with Hamm. It was Mike Jones who lost him that time. Remy Ojo is certainly not bashful about throwing his body around. Hamm just super quick. Scored 42 goals in 14 games this year for the Spiders. University of Arizona standout. Currently attending dental school in the Bay Area.
I really enjoy watching Hamm, mostly because I think he's so good at setting up his cut about two throws before the time he ends up with the disc. He's got a lot of foresight that he uses to his advantage. He has scored so many points for the Spiders just by anticipating when it's going to be prime striking time and being right there.
Cohen is chasing Cam Harris around this point. Lindquist doesn't have a mark on. Swings it to Masekele. You know, similar to Mark Lloyd, Masekele's become a well-rounded player. He can play behind the disc, but wouldn't you say Toronto's probably the most dangerous when he's doing work downfield? And a travel was called on Toronto. It'll be San Jose's possession.
To answer your question, Evan, yes, I do think so, and it's because he's such a dynamic player. When you have someone like him who can make the grabs that he does and then turn around and make a smart throw into the end zone, that's the kind of player you definitely want in the middle of the field, just because they are more than likely to either catch the goal or throw the goal.
First throw from Kittredge was complete to Matt Natale. Now here's Kevin Cox. Dumps it back for Kittredge. Russell Wynn shoots it up the line to Zaccaro. And the foul will allow him to center the disc.
Well, I really did not like that foul. That was shoulder first into a player who had already caught the disc clearly. Just a ridiculous foul.
Harris apologized immediately, but again, as you said before, that doesn't make it okay. Russell Wynn's in the end zone for the goal. 4-1, San Jose.
And like Cohen's earlier foul, Harris had perspective the entire time. He knew where he was going. He knew what he was doing.
Right. So, you know, I had the great fortune of playing a few years of co-ed ultimate. And, you know, when you're on the field, when you're built like me, I'm 6'3", 220. When you're built like me and you're on the field with women, you have to make sure not just run around wildly and make bids. You have to look out for the other players on the field. And I think it applies just as well to the men's game. When there's somebody who's making a play and they can't see you, but you can see them, it's your responsibility to protect that player.
Scott Hasty trying to get his team fired up. Big pull for Kevin Dollar-Smith. Out of the field with Justin Norden, who will put a mark on McKnight. When you get broken multiple times in a row, your typical offensive line is not necessarily out there. Jeff Powell, Liam Bradford. Not O-line starters, but playing this O-point for Toronto. And here's a deep shot looking for Powell. Kittredge couldn't cut the angle off properly. And what a beautiful throw from Cam Harris.
Absolutely fantastic. First of all, you look at the release. He puts just enough inside out for that baby to float. But he also threw it so that it was high enough that it was well outside of the reach of Bo Kittredge, but then came down softly for Jeff Powell in the end zone.
Chuck, when that disc went up, did you think Bo was going to make the play on it?
Well, you could tell he wasn't going to be able to run onto it, but it looked like he was right at that crucial point where if his rib were healthy, he might have just gone for it. But it's probably, you know, discretion is the better part of value there. If he went for that disc, he would have had to sacrifice a pretty heavy impact on his body.
Nice throw, as Megan said, from Cam Harris. 47 goals, 45 assists during the regular season for Harris. Cam's older brother wanted to impress a girl in high school by making the Frisbee team, so Cam was forced to practice with him. It worked out. Cam's brother ended up marrying that girl. She became his sister-in-law a few years later.
Wow.
Back in the hands of Ashlyn Joy.
So Ojo shut down Simon Higgins in the lane again. I'm really, really liking the defense he's playing.
This is Chuck Cow, up line for Joy. Again, Ojo denied the up line for Higgins, but it's Sean Hamm breaking free of Jackie Howe for the goal. If one weapon is covered, find the other.
Yeah, with a team like San Jose, you simply can't take all of the options away at once. So the only thing you can ever do in a single point is simply triage, try and take away the most dangerous person at a given point. But even then, it doesn't always work.
I was asking around the Western Division for scouting reports on the San Jose Spiders, and someone told me that if you don't bother Ashlyn Joy, he basically becomes Aaron Rodgers. Just pinpoint, comfortable, can pick you apart one by one.
So how do you bother him?
Do you get physical? Is that what you have to try to do?
It might be.
Harris looking long again. Massick Kelly over Kittredge. And he'll pick up the assist to Armitage. Heck of a grab from Isaiah Massick Kelly.
Absolutely. I really didn't think that he had position on that disc.
Yeah, so we're starting to get some answers on where Bo's at. He's still got that speed, but he looks a little tentative going up. You know, not quite that coordinated, explosive, full-body effort that we're used to seeing here. But the speed is there.
I also think that he probably couldn't have anticipated that Massick Kelly would stop his momentum and change directions and make that play. That was such a fantastic read by Isaiah that I think that was probably very difficult for Bo to adjust in time.
Yeah, agreed. Coming from behind against Massick Kelly's tall order for anybody.
Comp throw to Steve Armitage.
You know what's fun to think about? 10 years age difference between Massick Kelly and Bo Kittredge. That's kind of crazy to wrap your head around.
And they're pretty similar players, even with one being 10 years older than the other. Makes you think about what Massick Kelly can accomplish the next 10 years, too. Joy with a tough throw. Ojo defending, and he read it better than Higgins.
Yeah, I'm telling you, Ojo's really got him locked up. I mean, if Higgins is the plan, there's a problem with that plan.
And Ojo seems to have brought his A game today. He had that disc numbered the entire way.
Andrew Watts picks it up. Tough time in the first reset, but then Jones to Vasiliev, and now Powell downfield. Sanchez playing D. Scoober for Vasiliev, who shook away from Cal. Under 3 minutes to go in the first quarter. Toronto looking for its first break. Timeout was called from the Toronto sideline. Andrew Watts, when he heard the whistle, he thought the travel was coming, or the stall, I should say. And when he saw the timeout call, he was a little relieved.
Oh, absolutely. I assumed at first that it was a travel call, too.
Stall, you mean?
Stall call.
I prime you for that. Thanks. One, Megan. That's my fault.
I was listening to you too much.
So Toronto keeps the disc. 2:37 to go in quarter number one. The Spiders, the defending champs, lead the 2013 champs by two.
Strike up the band. Stevens Creek Toyota is ready for another all-star season. We're your home for everything Toyota in the South Bay. Experience Toyota Express service in our beautiful new facility, fast in, fast out service. We have deals to beat the band on Corolla, Sienna, and America's favorite hybrid, Prius. It's a performance you don't want to miss. Now it's Stevens Creek Toyota in San Jose. Visit us online at StevensCreekToyota.com.
Isaiah Masekele will retake the field with the Toronto offense as the Rush try to get back within one. The D from Remy Ojo on the Ashland Joy shot intended for Higgins. There's the zip line, the moving target challenge. Part of the spirit challenge. Check this out. That's Taylor Pope from the Raleigh Flyers. And just like the Raleigh performance today, a little uneven. Apologize, guys. Couldn't help myself.
That was too soon. Too soon, Evan. Let the wounds heal.
Here's Lindquist in the red zone.
Oh,
over
gosh.
The top to Yearwood. Why not?
What wind?
What is it about that? Is it the throw or the decision or what that makes you react like that?
Oh, both. I just was surprised that he was on 1 foot. It looked like he was pivoting around to make a break. I don't know if he faked himself out or was just faking me out, but he hesitated in the air on 1 foot and just released a little upside down pass.
Impressive completion to Yearwood. Jeff Lindquist, certainly a veteran, 30 years old now. Played for Team Canada. He's been a star for his country. Had a great season a couple of years ago with a Rush as well. Pull lands inbounds. Marcy lets Rasmussen pick it up. First throw, Hawk looking for Joy. Off the fingertips. Harrison's footsteps were lurking, but Ashland certainly feels he should have made that catch. And now the Spiders O-line forced to play defense again. To Carroll. This is a fun matchup too, Carroll and Rasmussen. Deep shot, what a throw. Higgins versus Powell, and Powell not in the end zone, but he hauled in the catch. High backhand to Watts for the goal, and we're tied. Pretty good sequence these last couple of points from the Toronto defense, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, and it's so fun to watch Powell going after a disc, man. He's just hungry. Goes up, makes the play, very athletic, very able to make adjustments, and Simon Higgins wanted that deep pretty bad.
Powell plays the game with a pretty good appetite, doesn't he?
He does. He's got hair like Yokao Oka, too. Need to get some stills. Need to get some action shots.
Yokao Oka, former San Francisco flamethrower, played one game for San Francisco in the AUDL this year. Like Powell, a defensive star, and like Powell, the locks to go with it.
You know, I've been to the horse races all of once in my life, and my friend looked at a horse and said, that horse looks confident. She put money on the horse, and the horse won the race. Yesterday, we had the privilege of running into a few of the Rush players in the hotel lobby, and when they walked in, I thought, now there's a team that looks confident.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say San Jose didn't look confident, but I think certainly both teams exuding belief
sure,
in themselves.
Sure. I still think that Rush has something I haven't quite seen in them before.
That's a good-looking horse.
Offsides call allowed San Jose to begin at midfield. Joy marked by Howe, gets it to Rasmussen. An aggressive pivot reset for Joy. Pretty effective
wow.
Double team until it wasn't. How about that creativity from Cassidy? Rasmussen to Marcy for the score.
You know, you certainly can't say that your double team failed when a person is forced to throw a throw like that. But unfortunately for Rush, a player like Cassidy has that particular type of throw.
Yeah, he sort of moves at a different speed sometimes. You see him faking with the disc and reacting and changing directions, setting up cuts, and it's just like, it takes him one step for everything that takes everybody else two steps. You know?
This is a pretty effective double team here, Chuck, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. Lots of trouble. Yeah, just somehow just tucks that right around the right leg here of Kubanek. Watch this. All kinds of trouble. Immediate pivot from a forehand, trying to lunge through the double team, just kind of scoots around and just pushes it around the leg.
Well, we had an offsides, and then we had a pull sail out of bounds. 63 ticks on the first quarter clock. McKnight guarded by Cox. Lindquist. Cam Harris shook free of Russell Wynn for a moment. Reyna, little circular cut to find some space at the midfield line. Now the first touch of the point for Massa Kelly with Kittredge chasing, and a deep shot, Yearwood against three Spiders. And Yearwood should have made that grab. That was a drop more than it was a D.
Yeah.
Matt Natale was the closest defender. The Spiders have 20 seconds. Big shot thrown up by Peterson. Russell Wynn in the end zone for San Jose.
Wow, did that set up perfect.
And the near side referee is claiming that a timeout was called, and they're going to wave that off.
And Isaiah Masakelli with his arms up in the air cheering for the timeout from the San Jose sideline.
Wow.
Tough break.
What a put from Peterson, and it's nullified by its player coach. So during the timeout, we get to watch a little more zip lining.
Is that Meshnick?
Yep, that was.
And they need to find some better throwers over there, it sounds like.
Gotta throw a leading pass.
It's not easy, Chuck. It's not easy.
You did it on the second try.
It did take me two tries.
It looks so easy from sitting in this chair. It looks so simple from up here.
So the Spiders will have the disc, the clock set for 17 seconds, and there's Kevin Smith undoubtedly feeling a tad sheepish at the moment. Bo Kittredge, Simon Higgins, Greg Cohen, Marcelo Sanchez, Ashlyn Joy, Cassidy Rasmussen, and Chuck Cow for San Jose. It's Vasiliev, Carroll, Harrison, Howe, Powell, Ojo, and Masakelli for Toronto. One of the best handlers, marked by one of the best handler defenders in Joy and Vasiliev. Joy's taken off. That disc was tipped by Masakelli and then snagged by Ojo. Powell with a bomb. It'll fall short of the end zone, and it's tipped to the ground by Chuck Cow. And that's how the first quarter will conclude.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Evan. What just happened in the sky? I just saw one of the craziest Ds I've ever seen in my life. Look at this play from Ojo.
I think it was after he caught the disc that was so impressive. He sort of flew a good 4 or 5 yards, seemingly, after he snagged possession.
Wow.
Just to make sure, I suppose I will fly through the air like a black dragon and catch this disc.
So Toronto cannot capitalize on Ojo's tremendous airplane-like layout, but they do deny a San Jose score that looked like was in the bag after the timeout nullified Peterson's deep shot for a win. We'll take a break. 12 minutes in the books. Good game here in semifinal number 2, 6-5, the defending champ San Jose leading the Toronto Rush.
What's all this?
My own line of products, Barkley 34.
It smells like a locker room.
Exactly. That's the round mound of pound cake.
Perfect. What's this?
The Rebounder. It's a dating app for the newly available.
Sounds promising. We build it?
Yes. CDW designed and installed our server infrastructure so we can respond quickly to any data demand.
Any?
Any.
I like it.
then you're gonna love Stir Charles.
Great times on the zip line here at Avaya Stadium in a tremendous sequence to end the first quarter. What you got?
That was Rami Ojo, I think, soaring through the air. I didn't get a close look, but I saw somebody flying at an impossible height through the sky.
Must have been Rami. Who else could it be?
That was a heck of a play.
Aside from that Ojo layout, should we come up with another word other than layout to describe what he did? I don't know. What else stood out to you from that first quarter?
San Jose got up early, and it was starting to look like kind of an uh-oh repeat of what happened in Toronto. But Toronto came back with a lot of fire. Isaiah Masekeli took Bo deep a couple of times. I don't know. I mean, it does kind of look like when the chips are down, Toronto might have the best players on the field. That's a surprise to me.
Toronto was down 5-2. They came back to tie it up 5-all. San Jose scored the last point of the quarter when Rasmussen broke the double team and hit Marcy. Lindquist at midfield, marked by Cohen. Definitely a partisan crowd here in San Jose as Armitage can't get there. A mistake from Masekeli, but a giveaway in response immediately out of the hands of Zaccaro. Lindquist to Yearwood, and he's in the end zone. And we saw in the first game today, Raleigh's undoing was arguably its inability take care of the disc after making a great defensive play or after the other team made a careless mistake. Madison made far fewer careless mistakes, and here Masekeli with a mediocre throw, and then Zaccaro just
give Armitage
credit, but he was a little careless in telegraphing that.
Yeah, that was great awareness from Armitage. That's not easy to pick like that. Carl's not only setting it, not only is he not giving you time to react, he's also stepping forward, stepping through the mark to kind of ensure that he gets it off. That was a cool little gamble from Armitage.
Opening up a lot of space on that far side of the field for Sanchez to cut. Low throw and laying out, it's Higgins. Joy to the horizontally cutting Cal. Bullet to the end zone, tipped by Ojo, caught by Higgins. Just like Kevin Dollar Smith threw it up. Or not.
Yeah, this was kind of interesting. There was a kind of a pause. You know, he looked it off at first. And then kind of, you know, acted like he was going to reset the disc and then pulled the trigger, trying to trick Ojo out of being in position. Ojo was still in position to make a touch, but not quite the entire D.
Simon Higgins in 2015 for the Spiders, 38 goals, 35 assists. He led the Spiders in goals in 2014 with 51. Another solid season for the youngster, now at the ripe young age of 22. On serve here in the second quarter. Contact and caught anyway by Lindquist.
Lindquist is another player who has been having an absolutely stellar year. He's just barely behind Masekeli in all of the stats. Today, playing very, very adeptly. We've seen him make some really tough throws, really tough grabs. And here we are, just still at the start of the second quarter.
And there's a confidence for the way he cuts out there. Now throws this one up with a stall count rising. Masekeli and Harris both nearby, and it's Harris all open, and then Masekeli all alone.
I am becoming a huge Toronto Rush fan. What was that throw? That was so cool. Lindquist just carves this IO backhand out to space.
Well, I mean, it's a smart throw with a stall count rising, understanding where your guys are and where they'll have an angle to catch a floater.
That's a good point, and where San Jose wasn't.
Yeah, no argument for me. I just literally didn't know that that was an option until I saw it. That was very well done. Look at this throw.
This is like a throw that you would make on the beach if the beach was this wide.
But you might be right. I'm impressed. Lindquist, look at that angle. I mean, it's like a chip shot. This looks like a golf shot. PGA Championships next week in Wisconsin. That's what I would expect to see. Whistling straights.
Really, and hats off to the rest of the Rush players. It can be very easy to be caught off guard by a throw like that, like we clearly were. But instead, Cam Harris, very quick to realize what was going on, made a bid for it. Saw Masekeli had also reacted.
If you wanted to be critical at all, you could criticize the San Jose defense for not really reacting to the unorthodox cross-field floaty backhand thing that Lakewood just threw up there. Marcy marked by Jones.
I feel like my language isn't sufficient to call this game. There's so many things I don't know how to say using words.
Ham with a quick dump for Rasmussen. Marked by Carroll. Takes a deep shot looking for a Ham. That's not going to work.
Wow. Kind of a strange choice there. You can tell... You know, San Jose, this offensive line is used to having a lot of success early and often, and when they don't, you can see they start to try to force it. And Toronto looks very good right now.
The Rush were down 5-2. Now they're looking for their first lead, but it won't come on that throw. But you're right, Chuck. It's not often that you see the Spiders' O-line get flustered.
Yeah, they don't have Bo out there. Simon just straight up does not have any advantage whatsoever on Ojo. So it's,
wow. Big layout from Powell, but a foul was called as Sanchez had the position.
Yeah, that's to get that's to catch the disc on your own goal line. That's how hard that was. Toronto looks great on D right now.
Ham on the under. And a big layout, tip, but caught by Joy. And then Harrison almost got a piece of Ashland's flick. And Ojo lays out again.
Yeah, I mean, this is D. This is D like we haven't seen. San Jose is not used to this. They're not up for it. They're getting beat.
If he wasn't already, Remy has to be in Simon's head.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Stall count rising, Powell shakes free. The disc skills from the Toronto D-line, a factor that wasn't discussed much before the game, but stands out now. Vasiliev just a little shy of that shot from Carroll. Andrew Carroll put his hands on his head. No, he wanted a little more float.
Yeah.
Yeah, and seconds earlier, Remy Ojo was open going deep there. Crowd wanted to see that one, for sure.
Higgins on the under. Doubled by Jones. Basic resets becoming quite difficult for the Spiders as Rasmussen was fouled by Carroll. Bullet flick to Sanchez. Nobody's really making deep cuts here for the Spiders. Sanchez just got incidentally tripped up by Powell on the far side. No whistle. Joy bluffs a huck. Hits Higgins under. It's a long point that's lasted more than 3 minutes. And a timeout called by San Jose. Toronto reacted like they just scored on the sidelines. I think the coaching staff really pleased with the defensive effort that the Rush have Wade so far. Timeout on the field, 6:17 to go. Second quarter, all square, 7-0. Well, the Toronto Rush have played this first half with a remarkable dose of intensity. Some fresh bodies coming on the field here. San Jose will have the disc. Everything's been difficult even on the goal line for San Jose.
Yeah, and this point right here that we're watching kind of the tail end of, was just one after another, and then eventually the big layout D by Remy Ojo, who else? Yeah, I mean, there's just no question. They are beating them up on defense right now.
They are challenging absolutely everything and are oftentimes rewarded for that effort.
Ojo's on the sidelines now, which has Jeff Lindquist on Simon Higgins downfield. Bo Kittredge is taking the field with Massick Kelly chasing him. Every one of these matchups is fun. Russell Wynn marked by Harris.
Yeah, look who's on the field right now. Number 50, Bo Kittredge. I kind of figured at some point,
out of the timeout,
when the O-line starts failing, Big Bo comes out.
Bo was going deep. The fans wanted Higgins to shoot it. Instead, under to Wynn, and then Bo. Joy shakes free of Howell on the dump. Low throw, clap caught by Wynn. Point has lasted over 4.5 minutes, and a traveling violation called on Jordan Marcy. Toronto has the disc, looking for its first lead of the game.
That is a tough loss of possession for San Jose. They have got to be kicking themselves right now for making that error.
And I haven't seen travels called this tightly all year.
Yeah.
Today has just been one after another. I would love to see a replay of that. What in the world happened?
Howell got foot blocked by Cohen. He wanted a call, it did not arrive. And Marcy nearly traveled again, but it was because Jackie Howe bumped into him. Nice cut by Russell Wynn, faking deep. Got Harris to bite, went underneath. And Marcy from the handler corps sneaks into the end zone. San Jose, for the moment, has kept its lead. 8-7.
That's a big conversion there from San Jose. I mean, this is the same point where Ojo got the big layout D, where a bunch of contested throws happen, and eventually San Jose does punch it in. That's a nice conversion.
There's Josh Cooper, the head official, explaining the traveling call to Jordan Marcy.
Marcy's smiling, I think, you know, Maybe he dragged his foot slightly while he was pivoting, but
maybe Cooper told him a joke.
Here we go. That was the call. I mean, are you kidding me? It's calling it a little too tight, if you ask me.
But Cohen with a foot block, just like he had on Matt Rader from Seattle in the Western title game. Refreshed the possession for the Spiders, and Marcy, with a little revenge, ended up scoring the goal. The point when he was whistled for the mysterious walking violation. That last point took over 5.5 minutes, almost half the quarter. Miscommunication, and again, who else on the defense creating havoc? Cohen may have got a piece of the D, even if he didn't. The handler dump had vacated the backfield. Zaccaro pivots the disc for Peterson. And Kittredge.
That's a big travel from Kittredge.
Although a receiver's travel, perhaps.
Right.
Tyler Grant shoots it, and a leaping catch of the hammer. Brett Peterson climbs the ladder for the San Jose score.
It's funny, you know, it's a little like watching, you know, the Madison Radicals. Guys will be challenging them, and you feel like they're starting to fold and fade a bit, but then they keep scoring. They just keep scoring the disc, and that's kind of what you're seeing from San Jose. They look like they were getting beat up in that last point. By the way, they scored that point, and then they scored the next one.
Couple hammers on that throw to help the disc first move across the field and then down the field. Pretty nice catch with the Armitage footsteps looming. Well, that's a break for San Jose. 3.5 minutes to go in the first half. And the Spiders lead by two again. Largest lead for San Jose was 3 at 4-1 and 5-2 in the first. Great stack down the middle of the field here for Toronto. Kittredge is on Massick Kelly, who now has the disc. Carroll hits Yearwood up the line. Seth Reinhardt on the mark. Tough throw from Lindquist around Van Arsdale.
Lindquist looks so sharp today.
Another tough throw and another well-executed goal for the Toronto Rush.
Yeah, just Lindquist is just finding these very creative, very tight angles to throw into, and they just keep working. The guy's really dialed in. You can kind of see. Sometimes you'll see an athlete, and you'll just see that they're in the zone. You know, people talk about being in that flow state, being in the zone. Lindquist just looks like he's in the zone right now.
Absolutely. He's making shots that are very, very difficult. His margin of error is incredibly tight, and yet he's hitting them exactly where he needs to. Even though Cohen was close, he really didn't have a play on that disc.
Yeah, Kevin Smith.
I'm sorry, that was Kevin Smith.
Yeah, number 80 here. Really not out of position.
The goal to Jeff Bomber Powell for Toronto. His second goal for the Rush. San Jose's O-line back on the field. Marcy, Rasmussen, Cal, Ham, Sanchez, Joy, and Higgins. Certainly seems like San Jose's game plan is to not take too many risky shots. And as I say that, here's Sean Hamm, makes the play in the end zone.
But I wouldn't say that that was a risky shot. That was a beautiful throw down the line to someone on the open side who was wearing his defender at his back.
Layout from Andrew Watts, but he fell short. And Sanchez hits Hamm for the San Jose goal.
Yeah, I feel like there's this dimension to Sanchez's offensive arsenal that's just come into being this year. He's able to really hit these tight, flat throws out to space. He does it on the forehand and the backhand side. I mean, this isn't that easy of a throw, but he's been able to consistently keep these shots out to space. When he's got a cutter coming from the far side of the field, he's able to just hit that space well and let the receiver do the work.
In 2014, nobody played more points on the Spiders than Bo Kittredge. He played 70 more than anybody else. This year, Bo led the Spiders again. Marcelo only played 2 fewer points than Bo over the course of the season.
Yeah, he's an absolute workhorse for the Spiders.
Sanchez played every single game this year for San Jose. I think a workhorse is a great word to describe him. Important couple of minutes here for Toronto. They played a really solid 22 minutes of ultimate. Big hammer, Harris to Massick Kelly. Tough throw, made it look pretty easy.
Yeah, you know, and Bo does that once in a while. He was way off Isaiah Massick Kelly. You really can't do that against this team. Toronto can hit those all day long.
Already 3 assists for Cam Harris in this game. Not a very active mark, and as you said, excuse me, Thompson McKnight, beg your pardon. 19, not 91. So McKnight picks up the assist. ...28-year-old handler. Great shot from the outfield bar. A lot of fans enjoying the game from that end zone area. A lot of fans in the stands as well here at Avaya Stadium, home of the San Jose Earthquakes. And here's a deep shot looking for Ham again. Joy launched the backhand, and it was a beauty.
Wow, that was a next-level backhand. And Sean Ham made a couple moves deep there. Got a step. I mean, basically, Ashland just threw him open. Watch him set himself here, wind and deliver. Puts a little outside in on this, but enough air on it that basically it just drops in right over the head of Harrison. Nothing he can do, and Sean Hamm just struts into the end zone.
Sean Hamm's acceleration speed was pretty impressive there, too. Now, Gord Harrison, who was chasing him, not a slow guy, and the distance between those two guys widened considerably when this throw was in the air.
Well, you know what else is Harrison's got a lot of height, so I think that's why Ashland turned it over a bit. He made it kind of turn over left to right there because he knows he doesn't want to throw a jump ball to Hamm against Harrison. Man, when you throw that well.
Heard a PA announcer just share there was an unsportsmanlike conduct against Toronto, a 20-yard penalty. So San Jose is basically pulling from the brick mark. Toronto getting ready to receive the back line of the end zone. And a bladey pull that will roll into the end zone for Yearwood. Back to McKnight with Massick, Kelly, Lindquist, Harris, Armitage, and young Nathan Hurst. Tough throw. And Armitage thinks he had it, but he didn't, and Smith takes it away.
Wow, that's kind of a bold move from Smith.
Yeah, it was. It worked out though, didn't it? First goal of the day for Bo Kittredge.
Wow, he looks like he's in a little pain after that catch. That is not a good sign.
So Smith ripped it away after Armitage nearly made the great catch. And then Matt Crawford, little lefty backhand. Bo's gonna probably go to the sideline and say to Crawford, you could have hit me in the chest there.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you can see his disc is clearly down. I like it, you know? He just takes the disc. Hey, Armitage, if you don't mind, I'm just going to go score a goal. I don't know if that's going to be a problem for you.
Playing defense now, bro.
Yeah, seriously. Which side is Bo's injury on? Is it the left or the right?
I think it's the left.
The left. So he had to reach up with that left arm. That probably tore him a bit.
You said it before. He's definitely in much better spirits today than he was a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, he was like talking to a guy with a migraine 2 weeks ago. Soft voice. It was almost like, yeah, like, please leave me alone right now.
30-yard swing to Harris. And now further to the far side of the field for Yearwood. Van Arsdale wasn't aware, otherwise he might have had a poached D.
Yeah. Great work downfield from Armitage. He's not getting the disc right now, but he's really forcing the defense to guard him and adjust.
Looking up the line, Yearwood lays out, and the disc falls incomplete off his fingertips. 30 seconds and a half, the Spiders have a chance to stretch the lead to 4. No timeouts left for San Jose. It doesn't look like the Spiders need one. What a catch in the end zone! Brett Peterson ruled on the doorstep, and now the Spiders are in. Justin Norton the goal, but the highlight belongs to Peterson. With time winding down in the first half, the San Jose Spiders have their best play of the day.
Score
Yeah, Peterson has had a couple of really, really good catches, but none better than this one. Just a ridiculous full extension layout at the last second. The disc is dropping, and he goes shoulder high and just comes over the top, makes an excellent catch. The club junior catch of the game. Kevin Smith got the possession started with a big swing. And then Kelly Van Arsdale let a rip. 17 seconds officially on the clock here for Toronto as we resume play. Yearwood takes a shot. Going to be close to the goal line, and it's caught by Massick Kelly, but a yard shy of the end zone.
Wow, he almost got accidentally knocked into the end zone by one of the Spiders players.
Holy cow.
Great catch nonetheless. Look at him climb the ladder off the backside here. Just kind of takes a couple steps back like a volleyball player. And swoops in and makes the catch. Holy smokes.
Simon is like, where did he come from?
Yeah, Simon's having a tough day.
Well, for the second straight game here at Avaya Stadium, the score at the half, 13-9. Madison went on to beat Raleigh 22-19. We'll see how the second half develops between the Spiders and the Rush. The sun's setting here in San Jose. The Spiders hoping they have one day left in their season. Toronto with some work to do. At the break, 13-9, the Spiders lead the Rush in the second AUDL semifinal. Our halftime coverage coming up, but now we'll chat with Megan Tormey, who's down on the field with San Jose's Greg Cohen.
Thanks so much, Evan. Greg, let's first talk about the last couple of minutes where you guys pulled away. What exactly just happened?
You know, I don't know. Sometimes you just get on a little bit of a roll. I mean, that was a heck of a catch by Brett. I can't explain it. We just kept grinding. We had good marks. We were good downfield. And just had a good end of the half, I guess. That's all I can say.
Stark contrast to the way you guys started this game, which was a little flustered, a little flat, certainly a lot slower than we're accustomed to seeing you. How were you feeling as the game started to take off?
You know, I think we started feeling pretty good. You know, maybe we had a few nerves, you know, the new stadium, the crowd, it's all pretty good. But, you know, it felt great at the end. And, I mean, that's the score, 13-9. Obviously, something happened in the second half, so we got a little bit less nervous.
So what adjustments are you going to talk about? What adjustments are you going to make to continue the streak that we just witnessed?
I think we have to stay closer to our guy on defense in the second half, and offense has to be a little bit more patient. We had a lot of uncharacteristic turnovers in the first half from guys you don't normally see turning over the disc. But I think over halftime, we're going to calm down again, and our offense will play a little bit better in the second half, and we'll have closer marks and just be closer to our guy.
Okay, well, exciting first half. I'm sure the second half will be just the same. Good luck.
Thank you so much.
Evan, back to you.
Megan, thanks so much. Greg, appreciate the time. Halftime score, 13-9. What a sunset here in San Jose. The Spiders are in front.
We're going to teach your kids about sportsmanship, spirit of the game. We're going to teach your kids conflict resolution. They're going to have a great time. They're going to get an amazing message about cancer. It's not a death sentence. It's not something you need to be scared of. It's something that you need to have a winning attitude towards, like an opponent on a field.
AUDL has brought a lot of professionalism to Eric. The players are all big role models. They're perfect Eric ambassadors. They teach the game, they love kids, kids love them. It's just a great combination.
Go Team Eric!
We are Team Eric!
If you want to follow the AUDL on your phone, now you can. Download the brand new AUDL app on your mobile device and get up-to-the-minute news on your favorite Pro Ultimate team. This is your new home for live scoring, up-to-date standings, game recaps, highlight videos, and more. It's the new best way to follow Ultimate at the highest level. Don't miss any of the thrilling hucks, towering skies, or monstrous layout Ds. Check out the free AUDL app today. Welcome back to Avaya Stadium. A gorgeous evening for Ultimate here at Championship Weekend. And the Spiders leading the rush 13-9. There's a great view of the entire scene around the largest bar in North America, the Accuracy Challenge. A lot of great games for kids, along with a zip line down there. Some Madison Radicals were on the zip line. Some enough were nice to pop up into the broadcast booth and join me here at the half. Congratulations, guys. Jay Frood and Matt Weber, known as the Bearded Giant. Welcome. You guys, there were a few dicey moments down the stretch in your semifinal against Raleigh, but might have been your hand block that really helped put the game away. What were you thinking in the waning moments of the fourth quarter when Raleigh got it back within two, Matt?
I was nervous because I saw their Jacksonville game. Very nervous, but I felt we were in control the whole game. I wasn't too worried. We went out to a big lead, and we just kept going, and they kept fighting back, but I felt pretty confident.
For guys like Matt, this championship weekend experience is nothing new, although the Avaya Stadium experience might be a new tweak. Jay, this is your first trip through the AUDL. Yes. You've had to assimilate onto this roster coming into the middle of the season, but, I mean, it doesn't look like you've had any growing pains at all.
Well, no, I think just fitting into these guys. I've played it with a few of the guys at U23 championships a couple years ago, so I think when I came aboard, it was just like being home, so it didn't really faze me. You know, I just got in there and did my thing and, you know, helped the Radicals get to the final. So,
from being on the sidelines and obviously on the field in that first half against Raleigh, what was it that enabled you to go up by seven so quickly in the first half?
Well, I think our defense just really clamped down. We did a really good job of forcing them to have bad throws, and we really capitalize on those type of throws. So, you know, hard defense, hard man defense, hard zone really worked against their Raleigh offense and high-powered abilities. So I think we did a really good job of capitalizing on those things.
So I'm going to ask you about Matt in a second, but first I'm going to ask the Bearded Giant about what has it been like playing with this guy, and how has he just become such a human highlight reel on the defensive side of the disc?
So since the tryout, the combine, early February, he has made plays that I haven't seen before. And all year long, he has just made amazing plays. I cannot understand some of the stuff he has done so far. The layout Ds he has, it's awesome to watch. I'm glad he's on my side this year.
Jay, tell us a little bit about your Ultimate background. When did you start playing, and when did you sort of, you know, have the light bulb go off as, like, I could just throw my body around and get the disc whenever it's up in the air?
Well, when you're young and in college, you just find these things out, you know. Just one day I went out and started playing with the Mizzou team and, you know, just kind of picked it up. And I worked really hard to really get that USA team, the first USA team that was coming around. And so I really wanted to make that, you know, myself known by doing that. And then since then, it's just playing on the competitive side, really just pushing myself forward and playing with the best group of people out here. So, and that's, you know, that's obviously what we're doing here. We're playing with the best people out here and hoping we can capitalize and get a championship. So,
you know, I talked to Tim DeBile, your head coach, a lot, and I think after your debut, he was just sort of speechless. Jay Frood was all the only words that could come out of his mouth. Did you enter your debut in the middle of the season with confidence, or did you sort of make a play and then get settled in?
You know, it was a little nerve-wracking at first. You know, being from Kansas City, I feel like a little out of place. But, you know, once you get in there and you start playing your game, you don't worry about it. You play Ultimate, really. And that's kind of where I settled in and started doing my thing and, you know, turned some heads.
One more question about the Madison defense. Matt, part of that two-man mark with Andrew Meshnick. There are times when you guys are right on the disc, and there are times when you guys are both sort of sagging off. How do you sort of make those decisions about when to pressure and when to just sort of try to block the angle over the course of the game?
So, for the most part, we're trying to get a double team as often as we can. But once in a while, one of us are out of position, too far away when they swing it really far. So then we have an alone call where one of us is making and the other one's going to take the dump. And that's how I got my 1D. I called it alone for Meshnick. he took the mark on the sideline, and I sagged off. So it worked out. Sometimes it doesn't. Usually it does, but.
I know you guys have high expectations for your offense, and with good reason. Things got a little dicey today, and you're not you don't rely on the Hawks like other teams do. But man, did Tom Annan have some amazing throws today, or what?
Yeah, he is an outstanding player. It's really nice to have him back. You know, he's been gone for most of the season, but to have him in the big games, it really helps us out. He had some dimes out there today, and I mean, we're not going to be mad at any of those decisions. So, you know, he's a great player and he's a great athlete. So it really looks good when he's out there doing his thing.
There was a concerning moment for you guys before the game when Brian Hart went down. He's been one of your top players all season long. Certainly a two-way guy that can play offense and defense, goals, assists, D's. He does it all. What was the reaction like when he went down? I imagine there had to be a little sense of deflation in terms of the enthusiasm when one of your top players, you know, goes down and is taken out of the game even before it starts.
Yeah, we're running 3-on-3 drills. Everyone's getting pumped up, screaming rah, rah, Dickles, and having a good time. And all of a sudden, Hart rolls his ankle, and everyone's just kind of stomach dropped for a little bit. It was a little scary. You know, Hart's probably one of our better players. Anytime you lose one of your top players going against an athletic team like the Flyers, it's never good. But we were able to get it, and hopefully he can play tomorrow with us.
You said you watched the game that Raleigh played against Jacksonville. What stood out to you about playing against Raleigh's offense on the field today?
They do have, all I heard all week long is how amazing athletes they have, and they do. They love throwing deep. Unfortunately, I think that plays into our hand really well at the zone, is the teams that want to jack it, you know, that's what we want. Throwing to Peter Graffy is a great win for us.
It was scary when Graffy went down today as well, but thankfully he's okay. Well, let's talk a little bit about tomorrow and about this game that you guys have been watching with us up here in the booth for the last few minutes. San Jose leads Toronto 13-9. I'm here with Jay Frood and Matt Weber from the victorious Madison Radicals. What has stood out to you from the first half of this game with San Jose and Toronto?
San Jose is always very crisp with the disc. They're really paying attention to what matchups they have that are benefiting them against the rush, and so I think that's why they've capitalized on a few times here and why we see the score 13-9. But you know, the Rush are still an athletic team. They're going to come back, they're going to fight and claw every time they can, so this game is not over by any means, but I think it's going to be a good matchup at the end.
People forget that last year the Radicals really controlled most of the first half against the Spiders, gave it away a little bit in the second quarter. Apologies for bringing it up. I'm sure you don't care who wins. You're happy to be in the finals. Yeah. And at the same time, you'd love to get another shot at San Jose. What from last year has lingered in your mind the most about that semifinal loss to San Jose?
We came out hot last year in the first quarter. I thought, just like tonight, we played great. In the second quarter, we started fading. San Jose came in, and they kind of took control of the game. And since that day, you know, Toronto beat us our first year in the championship. But for some reason, that San Jose loss was even harder to deal with. So this game has been great, but I kind of want San Jose. I want to play and beat San Jose.
You guys have played a lot of ultimates, so playing a back-to-back days is not a problem, but how do the legs feel right now a few hours after the first game? Could you go out there and play again right now?
You know, to be honest, I think a lot of our legs are feeling pretty fresh. You know, our defensive lines kept the O-line off most of the game. And I think it's really helped with, you know, the recovery process. I think a lot of our defensive guys are very fresh. Our O-line could have gone out there and played, you know, another game potentially. So I think we really did our job today, especially the defensive side. And it's going to show, I think, tomorrow when we play whoever the winner of this game is.
What did the head coach, Tim DeBile, say after the game?
He was very happy. I've never seen him so stressed before. Normally he is a lackadaisy kind of guy, but he was stressed throughout that game. It got a little heated for a while down on the field, but we came through for him. I'm happy.
You could tell there was excitement, but there was also a little sense of relief.
Yes, 100%. That I'm glad we got the win for Tim, and we're back in the finals.
They are back in the finals. Matt Weber, the bearded giant, Jay Frood, an AUDL rookie, both with great futures ahead of them, most notably tomorrow against the winner of San Jose and Toronto. The Spiders lead at the half 13-9. Chuck and Megan will rejoin me when we come back. Thanks so much, guys.
Thank you.
13-9 San Jose, second half coming up here at Avaya Stadium.
What's all this?
My own line of products. Barkley 34.
It smells like a locker room.
Exactly. That's the round mound of pound cake.
Perfect.
What's this?
The Rebounder. It's a dating app for the newly available.
Sounds promising. Can we build it?
Yes. CDW designed and installed our server infrastructure so we can respond quickly to any data demand.
Any?
Any. I like it.
Then you're gonna love Stir Charles.
Style with engagement. Style with confidence. Style with consciousness. Style with vibrance. A wave of social change being born. Wave born. Style with impact.
On the field, the long distance throw competition continues to unfold. Up here in the booth, I have some friends who are more my size, although Chuck's still a big dude, but Megan, it's more pleasant to stand next to you than the bearded giant. You're not quite as intimidating. 13-9, San Jose leads Toronto at the half. We'll check out the first half highlights. Some incredible plays. The defense that Toronto played was what really stood out early in the game, despite catches like that from Greg Cohen. You really thought Toronto's defense was the difference.
I did. I thought their man defense is probably the best I've seen all year in any division, and they really had San Jose worried. I mean, look at just this catch. This is just to get out of the end zone. This catch here where, you know, Ashton's just getting berated, and then two throws later, Ojo gets a layout D on Simon Higgins. I mean, it was looking really bleak for San Jose.
And yet, Toronto came up with a few mistakes, and San Jose, Megan, scored the final three goals of the half. It seemed like they took a deep breath collectively and started to take care of business a little bit more crisply.
Yeah, with time ticking down, they really just absolutely exploded and became the powerhouse we're so accustomed to them being, which just goes to show that Rush absolutely cannot afford to take their foot off the gas for a single second, because San Jose will capitalize.
Yeah, the final score of the half, as Brent Peterson into the end zone, laying out. He wasn't quite in the end zone on the layout, but Peterson picked up the assist as Van Arsdale let it fly with the clock winding down. Just like the first game of the day, one team closed the half on a 3-0 run. It was the team that was trailing to get back within four. Raleigh made it 13-9 earlier. This time, the team that was ahead by one went to the half up by four. The Spiders 13, the Rush 9, the second half coming up.
Strike up the band. Stevens Creek Toyota is ready for another all-star season. We're your home for everything Toyota in the South Bay. Experience Toyota Express service in our beautiful new facility, Fast In, Fast Out service. We have deals to beat the band on Corolla, Sienna, and America's favorite hybrid, Prius. It's a performance you don't want to miss. Now it's Stevens Creek Toyota in San Jose. Visit us online at StevensCreekToyota.com.
All the lights are on. The sun has just about set here in San Jose. We're right by the airport. You can hear planes all day long. You can see them, obviously, and seen some pretty good aerial tactics on the field here at Avaya Stadium as well. Really pleased by the crowd that has turned out. I know the league appreciates the support, and it's great to see the enthusiasm for the ultimate here in the Bay Area. All right, San Jose is going to pull to Toronto. The Rush will receive to begin this second half. Toronto's offense, guys, are you pleased with how they've played so far?
Absolutely. I think that they have done exactly what they intended to, which was come out and play their game, work their system. They knew that they would not have a ton of easy shots all game long, and so it was really up to all players to work on dumping and swinging and waiting until those shots sort of coalesced or came to be and then make them?
Yeah, they, you know, if there's anything they really need to work on, it's converting on D. They're really causing a lot of problems for San Jose's offense, but they're not punching a lot of those turns in. They really need to convert those. If they want to beat San Jose, they're going to have to break San Jose's O-line.
Beg your pardon. Rush on starting on defense. San Jose on offense to begin the second half. Another thing to think about is whether Toronto will start testing Bo Kittredge a little bit more when he's out there defensively. Ashland Joy with a big flick. Rasmussen gives up on it.
Man, look at how quick Cassidy is going deep. He got five steps on Isaiah Masekele before he knew what happened.
Vasiliev to Powell. Sanchez an active mark. Joy chasing Gord Harrison. And here's Jackie Howe. Was talking with Toronto's Mark Loy before the season and asked him who on the team he thought could really take a big step forward, and Jackie Howe was the guy he mentioned. All the physical tools, the springy athleticism to be a top flight defender. And Howe shook free a ham on the under. And it threw it away. It's Sanchez intended for Powell.
Yeah, Sanchez jumped the lane there all over that IO throw.
It's an official timeout, and Simon Higgins jogging gingerly off the field. Keep an eye on Simon, not sure what happened. Bo Kittredge will replace him. Maybe a cramp for Higgins, not sure. Watanabe comes off the field, replaced by Masekele. Another deep shot. This time it's Rasmussen seeking Joy. Cross field. That was beautiful. Ashland Joy putting on an aerial show for the San Jose Spiders.
Yeah, he's so talented with the disc. And you can see, you know, as they start to struggle getting production downfield from some of their usual suspects like Bo Kittredge and Simon Higgins, you know, Ashland Joy, you send him downfield and he is a nightmare. And, oh, by the way, when he gets the disc, he's the best thrower on the field too. You know, I wouldn't be surprised to see him and Cassidy, you know, we've already seen it here at the beginning of the second half, see them downfield cutting more. Because they can win their matchups. I think some of the big guys really aren't winning their matchups. But Ashland and Cassidy can still win those matchups.
Third assist for Joy. Sean Hamm with his fourth goal. Now on a day when Bo Kittredge is clearly not 100% and Simon Higgins has largely been neutralized, Marcelo Sanchez with a couple plays, but nothing outrageous to speak of. Guys, it's Sean Hamm doing the heavy lifting right now for the Spiders in the cutting court, along with Joy. Big shot from McKnight. Masekele. There was contact on Kittredge, but it went over both of their heads, and it's ruled incomplete.
Looked like Masekele bid a little bit earlier than he wanted to, simply because Bo was so close to him. Had he played against a player of less notoriety, I think he would have kept running for three more steps before making that jump.
Tyler Grant runs down the deep shot. Van Arsdale, the assist, the goal for Seth Reinhart. The Spiders have their largest lead of the night.
Yeah, that is bad news for Toronto. Masekele going deep against Bo Kittredge, turnover. And then a few passes later, a goal for San Jose. They're up six, and they're looking really, really smooth right now. So, I mean, this is a game of adjustments. In the first half, the matchups were kind of in Toronto's favor when it was San Jose's offense against Toronto's defense.
How about that throw from Kevin Smith, by the way?
Yeah, just a dime. These two guys won a national title in the mixed division with Mischief, I think, in 2000. And year was that? Seven? Six? I think it was 2006.
2006, Kevin Smith with his two brothers also on that team, Mark and Kyle. Kevin Smith's older brothers played the sport in college, helped get him started in Ultimate.
Kyle, by the way, is the best of the three.
Is he? Would Kevin agree?
I think he would. I think we all would. That dude's really good.
Sure, you taught him a few things in your prime in the Bay Area.
I let him beat me a whole lot. Does that count?
Well, you gave him some confidence.
Yeah, we can.
You do that with me too, Chuck. You give me confidence. Massick Kelly on the brink of the end zone. Hits Powell, sliding safely for the score. A very important goal there for the Toronto Rush. The Rush scored when McKnight hit Massick Kelly deep on the hammer with 1:50 to go in the first half. Then the Rush scored three times in the final 1:50 of that first half. The Rush scored twice before Toronto got on the board here. It was a 5-0 run from San Jose from 10-9 to 15-9 before this makes it 15-10.
Yeah, the momentum shift was so intense that it was almost easy to forget everything that happened in the first quarter, or the first half, leading up to the last 1 minute and 50 seconds of that half.
That pull will not come back, stays out of bounds. And again, it's going to be Ashlyn Joy beginning the point in the cutting core. Rasmussen, Marcy, and Cal, the handlers. With left to right, Higgins. Good to see him back on the field. Higgins, Joy, Ham, and Sanchez. And it's Ashlyn Joy, the first cut to initiate. And then taking off deep, Sean Hamm. A lot of traffic, and Rasmussen elevates over them all.
Don't sleep on Cassidy Rasmussen. That guy can climb the ladder. He's an absolute phenom going away. He just happens to be so good with the disc that he gets stuck around it a whole lot. But he had his eyes on that disc the entire time. I wouldn't be surprised if that was who the throw was to be honest. Cassidy took off and hit that second, third, fourth gear, and then the disc went up. Heck of a grab over a pack there.
You know, I like the way you say that, climb the ladder. I think an important point to make is that he's only 5'10", but plays like a much taller individual.
That was an awkward-looking kick spike, too, Cassidy, after the spectacular sky.
Conservation of greatness.
Tyler DiGirolamo is in town. I bet he would give Cassidy a little clinic on how to execute the kick spike more emphatically. Maybe he wouldn't give him a secret, I don't know. It was fun chatting with Tyler DiGirolamo and Jimmy Mickle on our Game Day live show this morning. Available on YouTube if you want to check that out. Interviews with players from all four teams. The plan is to do that again tomorrow at 2 o'clock Eastern, 11 a.m. here locally, in advance of the title game. So, you know, we chatted with Justin Norden, who's marking Thompson McKnight on the mark, and he said that the Spiders simply were just counting on that their depth would wear Toronto down. Do you think he was clairvoyant in that assessment?
Well, I think an interesting development we've seen so far is Sean Hamm really stepping up to the plate and making some big plays for San Jose. And I think that if you're Toronto, you can only think about matchups from the top, you know, top four or five players on the team. And after that, you don't really know what the other players are capable of when you take players like Bo and Ashlyn out of the equation, which isn't to say they've been taken out entirely, but Rush has done a good job of muting the kind of dominance they usually exhibit over a game. But players like Sean Hamm certainly are taking the opportunity to step up and be the playmaker.
After a lot of slow lateral movement, finally Lindquist hits Hurst for the score. A slow developing point there in the red zone for Toronto, which is probably a tribute to San Jose's determined defense.
Yeah, it looks like they've changed things up a little bit defensively. They are alternatively pulling off the mark a little bit, or pulling off their person and then tightening up again. So the rush can't ever be certain of a lane, because the Spiders are really kind of changing their position within the lane, so it's tough to make a clear, confident shot just given their inconsistencies in terms of where they're positioning themselves.
First, one of the many members of the Canadian U23 team that's on Toronto, but he's the only one that is here. Ian McKenzie, Taylor Kotwa, Jarrett Marin, and some others did not make the trip with Toronto. Hadn't played with them down the stretch of the season because they've been traveling after the trip to London, busy with other aspects of life. Marcy DeCal, member of that U23 USA team that won gold. Just off the fingertips of Ham this time. And an official timeout after the incompletion, as Toronto's Gord Harrison slowly hobbling off the field. Bo Kittredge walking on the field. It's not clear who's coming off yet for San Jose, but Bo just decided that he wanted to walk on, so Sean Hamm will march off. And Kittredge picks up Mike Jones. Yearwood to Carroll. An opportunity here for the Rush to get a break, and San Jose hasn't given the Rush many chances, especially over the course of the last quarter. Over the head of Ocho and intercepted by Rasmussen. Big layout from Powell on the poach, but unsuccessful. Kittredge called for the travel. Nice catch by Higgins, but it won't count. Bo walked with it, and it's a turnover. It does seem appropriate that a day when many travels have been called, a guy that is often accused of that violation was whistled for one as well. Whoa.
Looks like a travel was called. Somehow he lost his balance. It's hard to say what happened.
The foul on Cal, and from midfield, Howe to Vasiliev. Back to Jackie Howe, accelerating up the line. Low throw, picked up by Ojo. He says he had it. The referee says otherwise.
The San Jose sideline, which is 60 yards away, all saw it down as well.
Yeah, that's not surprising.
Yeah.
They got really good eyesight, that San Jose sideline.
And incredible. They had great perspective.
Yeah.
Joy and Vasiliev got tangled up on the near side, but both players emerged all right. Another big shot from Joy. Rasmussen in pursuit, he's got it. And a travel was called on Ashlin from the trail side referee.
2015 is the year of the travel here. The AUDL championships, I mean, is there ever a play where there's not a travel? He did get really wide though. I mean, it makes you wonder, did he drag his toe? He might have.
On the same point, two San Jose Stars, Bo Kittredge and Ashlin Joy, both called for traveling. If the Rush don't capitalize, they might not bother playing the final quarter of action. Howe couldn't leap backwards in, and a pick was called on Toronto, so Howe, I believe, will keep the disc, but he'll have to retreat 10 yards. Might be the first pick call we've seen today.
I thought it was the second.
Tough throw over the top. Higgins looming, and he elevates for the D. And now Higgins launches, looking for Kittredge. And Jones knocks it away. A roundabout, circuitous path taken by Kittredge.
Yeah,
and Toronto will take a timeout as they regain possession, as everybody seems a little exhausted out there This point started with 7:11 to go in the third. As you can see, now 3:39.
Kittredge misread that for a split second, and that was just enough for Jones to get into position to bother that disc, which is all it took. All it took for that play to be missed.
Look at this. Higgins.
I'm not sure what Jackie Howe is upset about there.
Should throw his hands up at his decision to release that disc.
Yeah, kind of, yeah, just, I mean, that sequence that we just watched is kind of indicative of what's going on in this moment. There's just.
And what's going on in this moment?
You know, it's kind of an existential funk playing out on a Frisbee field. Nobody knows what they're doing. What are we doing here? Are we trying to score, or do we just throw high release flicks?
Maybe he was worried about a travel call.
Yeah, everybody's keeping their foot down. And all kinds of things start happening when the feet stay down.
Lesson learned, a little bit of traveling is clearly good.
Can we get a look at that Ashland travel call? I'd love to audit the books on a couple of these these calls, because they may well be right. I mean, it's just something you don't pay attention to from the booth.
Here we go.
Ooh. How about it? That toe drag. Yeah, I saw his toe drag. He's such a good-looking guy, you're supposed to let him do that, I think.
On the restart, Toronto has possession. Hurst, McKnight, Yearwood, Harris, Armitage, Lindquist, and Massacelli. Isaiah could not come up with that one. Both Kittredge and Cox interfered.
Yeah, Bo is coming into
Cohen
form.
Is taken off. Harris is there. The deflection, and Cohen couldn't crawl, but he tried.
Certainly not for a lack of effort did that disc hit the ground.
Meshnick would have caught it.
That's exactly what I was thinking. It was the exact same type of play.
Yeah. Okay. And welcome to the AUDL Soccer Championships.
We are in Avaya.
We're in a soccer stadium. We are seeing some acting.
Armitage trying to get rid of the disc. He finally releases for Massacelli. Hurst was bluffing deep, but Massacelli took care of the possession. McKnight for Harris. Nope.
Yeah, these shots that were really on point in the first half of this game are starting to just get outside of the reach of the rush.
There were 5 points played in the first 5 minutes of the second half. This sixth point has lasted over 5 minutes. Lindquist called for the bump, trying to set the mark. Kittredge finds Cohen. Deep shot, beautiful throw, and San Jose scores. Cohen to Peterson. Spiders back up by 6 after a 5.5 minute battle.
I think Greg Cohen played in college with Peterson. I could be wrong about that, but they've got a real nice chemistry teaming up there. Both played at UC Santa Cruz. Both key guys on the San Jose D-line. Great D by Cam Harris on that last point. And yeah, here's just a beautiful throw. See something he likes, puts it right out far enough. Enough and flat enough.
Is it just me, or did that throw from Cohen look a little bit like an Ashland Joy flick? I interpret your silence as total and utter agreement.
Well, I thought it was a nice flick. I thought it had some good shape to it, but I thought really Peterson did a fantastic job of setting up that cut. You noticed him running towards the center of the field just enough to shake his defender and then cut right back out to the sideline. Made for a relatively easy forehand pass for Cohen. Not that it wasn't a beautifully executed throw.
Powell's been wide open this whole point. McKnight and Lindquist on the goal line play catch, and appropriately it's Powell in the end zone. So a 34-second point after a 5-minute, 38-second point previously. Yeah, nice patience from Toronto in the red zone. Junk defense didn't quite work out that time for San Jose, but the Spiders still getting set to receive with the best offensive line in the league and a 5-score edge. Minute to go in the third quarter here in the second semifinal. Toronto Rush, faithful, looking a little weary. Madison Radicals advanced with a 23-19 win, 22-19 over the Raleigh Flyers. Sanchez looking for Higgins. And Higgins shakes free again. Ham to Higgins.
For the first time this evening, it seems like Remy was unable to keep up with Simon Higgins.
Yeah, and that was a heck of a throw from Marcelo Sanchez. He's got these precision deep shots that just look, I mean, they look so high percentage. I mean, he's throwing it 60 yards downfield, and it just looks like a swing pass when he throws it. It looks like a guaranteed thing.
You talk about Ashland's balance, and Marcelo on that pivot seemed very in control too.
Yeah, he's able to really get out wide and low without moving that left foot. Yeah, somehow he's able to generate the same distance as a huck without changing the mechanics to a huck, because there's a way that you kind of straighten that back leg and really uncork it with your whole torso, and he doesn't even have to do that to throw 60-yard passes.
Tough layout grab for Vasiliev, lets the hammer fly. Lindquist in the end zone.
Wow, that was pretty cool from Vasiliev. Somersaulting through traffic, pops up, and then just throws a lollipop to his buddy Jeff Lindquist going to the end zone.
Those two guys have played together for a long time.
Yeah, lots of touch.
You know, I've made this comparison before, and I'm told that it's not a compliment, but I really feel like Tolley reminds me of Jay Cutler in that he can throw off balance. He doesn't need to have himself centered to be able to throw, but unlike Jay Cutler, Tolley will not throw an interception.
And he plays the game with a smile on his face. Vasiliev grew up in St. Petersburg, Russia. He started playing Ultimate when a team of international players traveled to his school. Less than a year after Vasiliev started playing, he was on the Russian national team. It doesn't happen like that in the United States. You have to play for a long time in most cases to get to that level. But in Russia, with a small Ultimate community at the time, Rasmussen got fouled. Went to a world championship event. I think he thought they were just gonna roll, and they lost their first game 15-1, I think, to Germany. And he realized, oh, we have some work to do. He's represented Team Canada as well. Can it get any better than that for San Jose? It's like the clock wasn't even a factor.
Yeah, they were simply playing business as usual offense.
Russell Wynn in the end zone with 4 seconds to go.
And this time, Kevin Smith did not call a timeout.
Just amazing. Higgins picks up the assist, and you know, the difference in perspective here, Toronto's gonna get the disc to start the fourth quarter. They're only down by five. And then you scored a hole to begin the thing. You're back within four. Six seems like a much taller task with just 12 minutes and 4 seconds to go.
Yeah, especially with how slow these points have progressed this second half.
McKnight got it off, and this is going to get to the end zone. Masakelli's nearby. It's tipped by Higgins and fell to the ground with Harris in pursuit.
I would like to see that again. I want to see how close Cam Harris was to making that play, or what kind of opportunity he had to make that play.
Yeah, he might not have had enough time to react. But yeah, if he could have clairvoyantly just bid, it does seem like he could have maybe caught him.
What a throw from Kelly.
Yeah, hard to tell.
Maybe not as close as I thought.
I think that was Thompson McKnight that just beauty there.
Yeah, it was a great throw from McKnight, but Higgins got the D, and Simon Higgins with a determined look on his face as he strode off the field at the end of that quarter. The Spiders at home trying to get back to the championship game. Lead by 6 at the end of 3.
What's all this?
My own line of products. Barkley 34.
It smells like a locker room.
Exactly. That's the round mound of pound cake.
Perfect. What's this?
The Rebounder. It's a dating app for the newly available.
Sounds promising. Can we build it?
Yes. CDW designed and installed our server infrastructure so we can respond quickly to any data demand.
Any?
Any. I like it.
Then you're gonna love Stir Charles.
Back at Avaya Stadium, home of the 2015 AUDL Championship Weekend. Tremendous spectacle has been created over the last 36 hours here at this facility. The efforts of so many people have helped get this stadium ready for these competitors. And in the third quarter, we saw more of the same from the Spiders. Ashlyn Joy to Sean Hamm, Ashlyn Joy to Cassidy Rasmussen. Familiar combination.
Yeah, we really watched the Toronto Rush start to struggle as the San Jose Spiders started to pick up momentum, and there were specific matchups that just didn't seem to work as well as they did in the first half. And it really looked like San Jose had kind of gotten their footing and were running as they were accustomed to.
Well, 12 minutes left in Toronto's season unless they can overcome a gigantic deficit. Lindquist to Carroll is a defensive player on the O-line for this first point of the fourth. Again, it's Lindquist with Cohen on the mark. Beware of that left foot. Carroll back for Link. Forced it through, and it's incomplete.
And that's one of the first decisions by Lindquist that just looked a little forced. I mean, he's been so perfect in a way with every throw he's decided to make. That might be the first time I've seen him do something that wasn't a good idea.
Yeah, he's been hitting those shots with absolute ease. Everything looking just a little more laborious for the Rush.
Win for Cohen. Lindquist trailing. Cohen's got it. Pretty good closing speed from Lindquist, but he couldn't get the disc first. And how about that from Greg Cohen? Why not? Largest lead of the night for San Jose.
Yeah, and you can see something kind of shift there for Lindquist. He made the error at the one end of the field. He got beat at the other end of the field, and then he kind of turned his back on Cohen, conceding the goal, started arguing with the ref. If I'm a coach, I want to immediately go address that with Lindquist, say, hey, buddy, we need you in this game. We need you to make this comeback that we're about to make.
Now you talked to him at the half, Megan. It's been a while since he's done something wrong in a big game. And Tali with the score here, but you know, Cohen doesn't strike you as a guy that gets nervous for big games.
Oh my gosh, no. And earlier when we were talking to Justin Norden, who said, you know, who's the most vocal guy on the sideline? Greg Cohen was one of the individuals he named. He said he's always a positive, happy energy. And both times I've interviewed him, I feel like my energy just could not possibly match Greg's. He's got such a passion, such a joy that just seems to exude from his body whether or not he even tries to.
So, Chuck, if you're the coach at Toronto right now, what are you looking to see?
Well, I mean, this O-line has really just got to start punching the disc in. We got to get the D on the field. We got to start breaking the O-line. So first things first, let's take care of business here. Go to whatever matchup you think is good. Maybe this is it right here. Powell against Smith for the score. So bullet point one, get the D on the field. Now we got to start breaking here. We've got some matchups we like. What are we going to do against Ashton? What are we going to do against Cassidy? Let's come up with a plan here and let's shut those two guys down. Because I think otherwise you're in decent shape on D. Maybe it's time to throw some of your looks, throw some of your junk looks, throw some transition defenses. But anyway, you got to start knocking them out here.
Not a bad catch here from Powell. Showing a nice proclivity for going up in the air late in the season. A tremendous highlight reel grab against the New York Empire and Toronto's East Division title game. A 6-goal win for the Rush over the Empire. San Jose surpassed Seattle 21-19 13 days ago up in Oakland. A year ago, Toronto was at home and fell flat against the Spiders. The final in that game was 28-18. One has been closer, even though San Jose got off to such a great start. Toronto closed the gap. In the third quarter, it was all San Jose. Stall was called on Sanchez. 7-second stall violation. And San Jose turns it over.
That's big. So check in the box for number two. We got the disc. Now we got to punch it in.
How many steps are in your plan here for Toronto?
There's about seven more.
Sounds about right.
Really, to me, it sounds like there's just two.
Score and
get
then
the
repeat.
Disc.
Right.
Harrison lets it fly for Ojo. For a goal.
All alone for reasons I'm not quite sure.
Well, I think Simon Higgins might have cramped up again. He was walking gingerly to the sideline after he let Ojo go.
Well, that one's on the rest of his team for not following. You got to help each other out.
Well, it's the first time in a long while that Toronto scored two in a row.
Yeah, and five goals with over 8 minutes left here, that is not insurmountable. But you're going up against the defending champs here. They will not let you take it from them without a fight. So we could be in for a nice finish here.
You can see after this play, Higgins reaching for that calf muscle.
Well, Chuck, the Rush are back on D. It looks like they just have to follow your two-step program. Let's see how they can handle step one, getting the disc.
Marcy, Joy, Rasmussen, Wynn, Ham, Kittredge, and Sanchez. It's the first O point of the game that Kittredge has started on the field for San Jose. Rasmussen takes off. Big flick from Wynn. It's going to float. Yearwood nearby. Pass interference on Yearwood.
Yeah, Cassidy was up way above Yearwood here. Not sure if he doinked it or if he just got fouled and wasn't able to catch it as a result of the foul, but he was up there. On the restart, an easy goal. Toronto very frustrated. Travel. I think they called a pick, an integrity rule, a pick in the back of the end zone.
Oh, interesting.
No harm done. Rasmussen, the dime for Sanchez. Marcelo always stealing Bo's stats. Kittredge had the goal, and now it's Sanchez who gets the score for San Jose.
Yeah, I'd love to see that foul up high with Cassidy. I'm assuming it was a good call, but those bang-bang plays, it's tough to tell. So here we see Cassidy going deep, Yearwood in pursuit. That might have gotten him in the hip here. Looks like he was into the body a little bit.
He got him down low, not up high.
Yeah, it seemed like a catch that he should have made, didn't it?
Yeah, it looked like he dropped it, but there was the contact.
Right.
Another goal for Sanchez, who's had a very solid game.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Have you ever seen Sanchez have a bad game?
I don't think I have.
I can't think of a single time where it's like, wow, he's really off tonight.
Does that mean we underrate him as a player by not putting him in the category with, you know, necessarily Kittredge or Joy?
Yeah, he's too consistent. I'm not used to consistency in my life.
Here's McKnight up the line for Liam Bradford. Adrian Yearwood stressed the importance of staying in their system. Not trying to change anything about them to try to beat San Jose. Just do what they do. They think that's enough. It might not be. That was a straddle of the end zone. Bradford wasn't in. Takes the tough choice, and the hammer won't be caught.
Oh, and an injury on the field.
Scary moment for Massa Kelly.
Looks like he might be cramping. Yeah, looks like a calf cramp, or hamstring cramp.
You know how painful those can be. He's played a lot of points in this game. Leaving everything on the line. And he just sort of tightened up there a little bit.
Yeah, so painful. I mean, when you've got a lot of muscle in your legs, you know, it's nice because you got all this muscle. The downside is when those muscles cramp, it is just brutal.
About 7 minutes to go. Massa Kelly getting looked at. We'll take a quick break. The Spiders leading the rush by 6.
Strike up the band. Stevens Creek Toyota is ready for another all-star season. We're your home for everything Toyota in the South Bay. Experience Toyota Express service in our beautiful new facility, Fast In, Fast Out service. We have deals to beat the band on Corolla, Sienna, and America's favorite hybrid, Prius. It's a performance you don't want to miss. Now it's Stevens Creek Toyota in San Jose. Visit us online at StevensCreekToyota.com.
We're back live, and you're seeing Isaiah Massa Kelly walking off the field with little help. Met the Toronto Rush trainer Kevin last night at the hotel. Sports chiropractor in the red Rush polo. Massa Kelly seems in decent spirits despite the cramp issue and the deficit. Another big shot. Cohen adjusted to it brilliantly.
That was ridiculous.
Into the end zone for Kevin Cox. The Spiders look like they're on their way to another title game. And Greg Cohen is a gigantic reason why.
He has just made some absolutely phenomenal catches today. Talk about adjustment on the move. Obviously, right now it looks like Steve Armitage was behind him, but as that play was starting out, Cohen had steps on Steven. So he paused mid-track, ran around Steve to make that catch.
How many times does a guy make a play like that, see a guy wide open deep, and rush the throw?
One more time, because he rushed his throw, but somehow he made a nice throw. I don't know. I mean, you saw him. He never even set his feet. Threw kind of from his waist, all arm. But it worked. I don't know.
Greg Cullen comes from a baseball background. He was a pitcher in high school. And what's a little surprising is that he was a left-handed pitcher. He plays ultimate righty, but he played baseball lefty. He was recruited by a number of Division I colleges to play baseball, but really just kind of lost his passion for the sport, wanted to try something new. He found ultimate, and that has become a true passion. Spiders are glad he did, as Andrew Carroll gets a quick response for Toronto.
I wonder what the most common sport is for an athlete to transition into ultimate.
Do you mean what has happened most frequently in the past?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just wondering, you know, there's got to be a, you know, maybe a poll that's out there as to what prior sports people have played. I know a lot of people ran cross country, did soccer, that kind of stuff, but I wonder if, I mean, how many baseball players, for example, are playing ultimate now? There might be quite a few.
Probably a small number, but I think probably basketball, soccer, football, and we see some tennis players transition to it.
Andrew Brown, big tennis player.
Craig Cohen. Craig Cohen was also a ping pong champion back in his youth.
You know, I feel like a lot of high school teams, high school cross country teams, played ultimate during the off season, which is how a number of players started as well.
I think you're right. Yeah, I have heard that.
And Sean Hamm with his first mistake of the day turfed it a little bit. Vasiliev swings for Watts. Time is running short for Toronto. Here's a rare opportunity to break. Ojo chased by Higgins back on the field. Hammer from Vasiliev. Powell.
Powell just doing a great job of being an open target in the end zone, regardless of who has the disc and where exactly the disc is on the field. He's making some great resets downfield, which is why he always seems to be the perfect receiver, the perfect target in the end zone.
There's that miscue from Hamm, setting up with another hammer from Vasiliev. It's obviously a throw he's very comfortable with, very accurate with. And he actually throws it with quite a bit of float. He kind of throws a little bit of a moon ball. A lot of guys flatten it out, really kind of carve it through the air. He just kind of throws it up there like a blade, lets it kind of slide down out of the sky into his receiver's hands. And he's got, I don't know, we've got it calibrated the way he does. It really is very high percentage.
Great pull for Jordan Marcy to the back quadrant of his end zone. Marcy handling with Rasmussen and Cal. Kittredge on the field. And Joy looking for Kittredge long. Harris defending. And Harris over the top comes up with a disc.
That's something you don't see every day.
Yep.
Imagine the reaction from the Toronto sideline if it was 22-20 right now instead of 22-17 after a play like that.
Yeah.
Through the hands of three players. Two rush, one spider, and incomplete. Official timeout as Chuck Cow was a little shaken up. Looks like Kevin Smith walking onto the field, and now he'll let Craig Cohen do the dirty work.
It's a a relatively cool evening tonight. I thought it might be hotter. Tomorrow's game will be much more under the sun. 2 o'clock local time, 5 p.m. Eastern. On ESPN3 and also TSN Go in Canada. Cohen all alone in the middle of the field. He lost Ojo. I'd love to see Cohen going away against Ojo. Who wouldn't? This will be a little easy. Ojo went tumbling, may have hit Cohen in the back of the head. Another goal for Greg Cohen, and the Spiders up by 6. Just under 4 minutes to play. So it looks like the Spiders and the Radicals tomorrow, guys. Last year it was 20-19 with about 5 minutes left in their semifinal. And Madison felt like they gave that game away in the middle stages of the first half when they had an 8-5 lead and then allowed the Spiders to go up by 3 at the break. Big 6-point turnaround late in that first half last year. Did the performance of either Madison or San Jose today change the way you're thinking about the game tomorrow?
Not for me. I thought Madison didn't really wow you. They played well. They played exactly as well as you would expect them to play, and they won. I think some people had Raleigh winning that game. I didn't. I thought with this kind of win in that zone and a really, really steady O-line, Madison should win that game, and they did. But, you know, this is the defending champ. They look good. And Madison looks up to the task. It could be a really interesting matchup.
Oh, wow. Looks like Yearwood thought there would be somebody else there. Was poised to lay out, make that catch, and decided not to at the last moment. This could be the nail in the coffin for San Jose, but not yet. Isaiah Masick-Kelly, back from the cramping issue on the field, registered the hand block on Crawford. And then Masick-Kelly, a laser beam. Armitage turns on the Jets.
You know, if you think about it, Rush has really been able to hold San Jose at 5, which it is what it is. But you think about the time in which San Jose got that 5-point lead towards the end, the last minute and a half, minute and 15 seconds of the first half, first couple of points of that second half. Really, besides that, they've been able to keep within striking distance if you take those five points out of the equation, and that is really what is costing them at this point.
Yeah, tough to come back against the defending champs. But Toronto, you know, they've got a tall order here to get back in 6 minutes, get 5 points back, in 3 minutes to get 5 points back, but it's certainly possible.
Joyda Sanchez, Kittredge, Hammond, Higgins, the fellow cutters. Rasmussen and Marcy with Joy in the handler set. That disc hanging in the air, and Joy runs it down. Closing in on 2 minutes to go in the final game of the night here at Avaya Stadium. Alert decision making there from Ham. He saw the poaching defender Howe from the far side of the field. Didn't throw it, but now Sanchez slips and Toronto could get it within 4.
if they strike. They need to strike quickly. Phil Watanabe, the eldest member of the rush, to Vasiliev. And Powell hits Howe in the end zone with 1:16 to play. At this point in the sport, there's no such thing as an onside pull. Nothing Toronto can do to try to get the disc back here without playing D.
I guess you could play for a dropped pull somehow.
It's tough to do when you're pulling 80 yards away.
Yeah, you'd have to come up with some elaborate distraction and then just throw it as hard and fast as you can at somebody who's not looking.
Well, one day when you're coaching a team, you can implement that strategy.
I'll work on it, you know. I'm not a good coach, folks.
So it was something interesting that Simon Higgins told me earlier this year. He said that, you know, when we played Madison last year, a lot of people thought we figured out the radical zone, but we really didn't, he told me in a moment of honesty. As we go under a minute to play, that's something to look forward to about tomorrow. And here is Higgins, keeps the feet in bounds. Remy Ojo, well, he's played a tremendous game defensively, but the tank is just about on the E.
So how did they win last year then?
I think it was really close. You know, went either way. Yeah. Madison made a couple big mistakes. You know, the one that stands out is at the end of the first quarter when Madison got a D and then Seth Meyer threw it right into the hands of Tyler Bacon, who alertly hit the open man in the end zone basically at the buzzer. And San Jose was sort of off and running after that.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this game tomorrow. I think it's going to be an interesting one. I think Madison is just better than they were last year.
Yeah.
And
add a guy like Jay Froud, who might be their most dynamic athlete. And a positive sign at the half, as Weber and Froud suggested, they think Brian Hart will be okay to play tomorrow, but we'll see about that. It's a beautiful shot there from Lindquist to Harris. Chuck Kindred to my right is just shaking his head up here in the booth.
Hey, Cam Harris just makes plays without jumping. Just by the way he approaches that disc, the line he takes to the disc, he forces the defender off his play. You know, never quite lets the defender get comfortable enough to gather their feet and make the bid. And as a result, Cam Harris just runs down another goal. Just a very crafty player and a guy who does it on, throws the disc like maybe no one else on Toronto. Just incredible range, incredible creativity with the disc, and then also just a really, really dynamic receiver.
Pretty lackadaisically perfect release there from Lindquist. He was sort of walking off the field as that disc was in the air.
Yeah.
Toronto within four, but time is a factor. Tomorrow at 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. local time, we'll have AUDL Game Day live on YouTube. Check out AUDL social media for more information about that. And then at 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 o'clock local time, the San Jose Spiders against the Madison Radicals for the 2015 AUDL title. A little exclamation point here, Mr. Kindred.
Yeah, nice play by him. You know, it's kind of cool to see Mark Lloyd, just 2 weeks out of ACL surgery, kind of hobbling onto the field to pick up his teammate who just got beat deep there. you know, this is a proud franchise and a franchise that's just going to be really fun to watch next year as they reload, get Mark Lloyd back, who's, I mean, he might be the best player in the league. It's a great group of guys, a lot of fight, great season for them. I'm sure it's tough for them to close it out this way.
There is Mark Lloyd, the general manager of the Rush. Tweaked his knee early in the season and then tried to warm up for a game on April 25th against Ottawa, and just cutting back and forth didn't work out. Final throw of the game, and Adrian Yearwood shot into an appreciative crowd, and the Avaya Stadium fans see the home team prevail. Final score 25-20. So for the second straight year, the San Jose Spiders are in the AUDL championship game. Last year, they beat the Radicals in the semis and the Rush in the finals. This year, they'll try to do the opposite. They're halfway home.
Yeah, this was a really fun game. You know, at the end, San Jose did pull away, but that first half was, I mean, it was electric. And Toronto, I mean, like we said, I think Toronto played the best man D that I've seen in the AUDL this year. That first half, it was something to behold.
There was a 6 or 7 minute sequence when they made their comeback where Simon Higgins was completely neutralized, where Jackie Howe and Andrew Carroll and Jeff Powell, Anatoly Vasiliev, they really had their way with some of the best cutters in the world.
Yeah, they were locked in on Sanchez. They were able to really neutralize Bo. I mean, Masakelli just handled him. Fun to watch.
Simon Higgins excited. The Spiders are back in the title game. Megan Tormey down on the field with San Jose star handler, Ashlyn Joy.
Thanks, Evan. Ashlyn, first and foremost, congratulations on that win. What did Toronto come out with that surprised you the most?
I think we knew exactly what they were going to do. They're going to try and take us out of our one-on-one matchups, and they did a great job. And we definitely struggled to move the disc. We had to work it around with the handlers a lot, and I don't think we've had a lot of challenges like that this year, and we definitely struggled. So I'm glad we were able to, it wasn't pretty, but I'm glad we were able to put the disc in the end zone and get a lead on them.
You know, at the end of the first half, you guys obviously excelled, but you looked like a different team stepping onto the field in the second half. What adjustments did you talk about during halftime?
I don't think there's any adjustments. I think the D came out and they crushed. They got a couple of breaks and it really fired up the team. And that's, you know, guys like Greg. Greg has played a hell of a game and got a bunch of blocks for us and made a bunch of big plays. And it fires up the team and then everybody else gets more confident. So I think that was a big turning point in the second half.
I know you're still digesting this game, but what are your thoughts about tomorrow's game?
They're going to be another team that like throwing the junk, and they have a really good zone. We got held up by that last year, and we had a really close game against them in the semifinals. So I'm going to expect the same thing, and I think the handlers need to be a little more solid with the disc tomorrow and make sure we don't make as many mistakes. I mean, we pulled this one out, but I think we have a lot to improve on, especially with the handlers moving the disc and not turning it over. So,
well, again, congratulations and good luck tomorrow.
Thank you.
Back to you, Evan.
5 assists, 31 completions for Ashlyn Joy tonight as the San Jose Spiders advance again. It's just what they do. San Jose perfect in the AUDL playoffs over the course of 2 years, and they try to get to another championship circle tomorrow. Evan Lepler back with Chuck Kindred. Your thoughts on Ashlyn Joy's performance tonight? Just a leader of this team, and, you know, without Kittredge on the offensive line as sort of that safety blanket. In the second half, it was Joy that kind of took this game over, feeding it to Sanchez, feeding it to Ham.
Yeah, he's a guy that when he's on the field, you know, much in the same way when Bo's on the field at the end of a game, you just calm down. You say, you know what, we're going to be all right because I know he can get open. I know he can make any throw that's needed. You know he can handle. You know he can cut. He can do whatever you need to do, and he's good in the air. He's good laterally. You know, he's a guy that never panics and has all the skills. You know, taking a look back at some of the throws he made. I mean, look at this throw to Ham, who just basically made a cut, almost a clearing cut, But the way Ashland throws to him, and it's a jog for a goal, it's really kind of remarkable the way he's able to shape the disc, get out wide, avoid the mark, and just punish defenses.
On the offense for San Jose, it was Joy. On the defensive side, it was Greg Cohen. I mean, how many times have we talked about Cohen in praise in the postgame? He just continues to amaze.
Yeah, and he's such a fun guy. I mean, you know, you see the halftime interview with Megan, and you're just like, man, I want to hang out with that guy. He seems like a really nice guy. But meanwhile, I was out there just making play after play, hanging in there. You know, he got kind of beat up a little bit on a couple of the plays, but always positive, always pushing forward, always smiling. I mean, he's really a guy that the whole team can key off of. You see some of the work he did in this game against a lot of pressure from Lindquist here. He closes out, makes the catch. You know, here's that great adjustment coming back to the disc, and then the little flick backhand out to space for the goal. You know, he's just a competitor. He wants to win. He wants his team to do well. You know, and he wants to have a good time, and it comes through. When you watch this guy play, you can really see the spirit behind the eyes, you know.
Before we get your last thought of the night and first thought about San Jose Madison, let's tie a bow on Toronto's season. You know, another Eastern Division title. They only lost one game all year. It was by 1 point to Montreal, only one regular season loss. A 5-point setback today. They lost to San Jose by 10 last year, and this year they were without Mark Lloyd. They were without Jonathan Martin. What did you learn about Toronto today that you may not have known beforehand?
Cam Harris can play, all right? I mean, it's not a news flash, but watching the way he cuts deep, some of the plays he makes when he adjusts to get to the disc, and then just the unbelievable throws he can make. He was fun to watch. McKnight had some throws that just make you scratch your head. Vasiliev with those hammers. And then Masakelli, just an emerging star in the sport. This guy is really, I mean, he's just so big and athletic. He can cut, he can handle, he's a competitor. I was just impressed all around, and let's not leave out Remy Ojo. I mean, this guy I was speechless at points during the game to see what he was doing.
Yeah, just a fantastic athlete to watch, especially when he's going up against someone like Simon Higgins. It'd be fun to chat with Simon after the game tonight about what it was like trying to get open when Remy was on him. So it will be Madison and San Jose, and we are looking forward to that one. I know, the Madison guys enter with confidence. They are not intimidated at all by the Spiders. I think last year going into the game, they might have been a little bit, and then they played them so well. You heard Matt Weber talk about it at halftime. They got off to such a good start in the game last year. They have the belief they can do it.
Yeah, and I think, you know, unlike the game today for them, the pressure's really off right now. Nobody's expecting them to win this game. I mean, I know they know that they can win it and they want to win it, but there's no pressure. You know, if they get down, no big deal. Let's stay calm. We can get back. You know, they can control. One thing they can do is really control the tempo of the game. They can take Ashland and they can take Cassidy and make them play Madison Radicals Ultimate. They just really don't have a choice with a defense like that. You know, and you're in the driver's seat as Madison, and that's got to give you confidence going into this final.
Well, wherever you are across the nation, across North America, across the world, we appreciate you being with us tonight on ESPN3 and TSN Go. The Madison Radicals over the Raleigh Flyers in Game 1, the San Jose Spiders outlasting the Toronto Rush in Game 2, which sets up another West versus Midwest title game. I said another. It's the first one, the first ever West versus Midwest title game. It'll be the Spiders and Radicals at 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 o'clock local time, here tomorrow afternoon from Avaya Stadium. For our entire crew, led by Luke Johnson, Josh Havens, Roberto Flores, Kelly Johnson, and others, and for my broadcast partners, Chuck Kindred and Megan Tormey, I'm Evan Leffler saying good night from Avaya Stadium, where the Spiders get the job done again, this time taking down Toronto by a final score of 25-20. We'll see you tomorrow as we'll decide the fourth AUDL champion. Good night, everybody.